Let's go.
It wasn't love. It wasn't love. It was a perfect illusion.
Hello and welcome to Once Upon a Time, the medium dive. It's not a deep dive. We're your hosts.
Addie.
Sydney.
Ooh. Okay, so Once Upon a Time, if you don't know, is a show that is all about fairy tale characters. Let me read you the first line. There was an enchanted forest filled with all the classic characters we know.
Or think we know.
One day they found themselves trapped in a place where all their happy endings were stolen.
Our world.
This is how it happened. Iconic.
Ran from 2011 to 2018.
Oh, I didn't know these facts. It was kind of a big deal. There was a huge budget for the show.
Was there?
Yeah. A big key about this show is that basically everyone's related somehow. So.
Hence.
Oh,
God. Buddy.
No.
Hold him.
Oh. Hold him? Okay.
Enter Gizmo.
Okay, good job. Everybody here, characters. Almost everybody here, is part of the family tree, somehow. And we will be revealing
the relationship lines, you know, drawing them with crayon.
Yep, on the wall. The only thing you need to know as we add in lines is we have four colors. The first one is pink. Which means if there's just some kind of romance.
It's a romantic relationship.
But nothing. Somehow. Next line is married.
Commitment.
These things can coexist.
Or they cannot.
Next one is
gray for adoption. A considerable amount of adoption.
Yeah,
it's
a pretty key
adoptions,
point.
Adoptions, especially season one, big major
yes.
part of it. Then we got black for miscellaneous related. There's a lot to get through. This video might be like 5 hours long. It might be two
Our goal
and a half
is
hours
to not
long.
Do that.
I'm just, we
Let's
don't know
Let's start with
happen.
The pilot. The name is?
Pilot. We open with Prince Charming. He's riding a horse. He's racing to Snow White's crystal casket. She's surrounded by the dwarves. We've all seen the movie. We know how this goes.
So Charming wakes up Snow White, of course, with True Love's kiss. And then there's a magic rainbow pulse of light that kind of like shoots outward. And that's going to be like a pretty consistent
mm-hmm.
show of like the breaking of a curse is mm-hmm. like it's all done and
we're finished.
She's like, you found me, and then he's like, I will
always
find
you.
That is their thing.
It's their thing. They say it a lot,
so hence
the poster. I will always find you counter.
But the thing is that it kind of gets annoying after time.
I love it.
I hate it.
Then there's an absolutely offensive transition to their wedding.
We got like,
oh, so
we need a
relationship rhyme. Red. She's wearing a beautiful feather dress. They're under a gazebo. Seemingly the entire kingdom is in attendance.
Wait, don't stop talking.
It wasn't love. It wasn't.
So they're married now. But then somebody shows up. It's Regina. It's everybody's favorite. The evil queen. And it's like literally just as they're about to kiss. And then she's just like, And it goes, dun 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 dun. Why are we all dun 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 dun? You went up. She comes to the wedding to threaten all of them. It's really her thing. Yeah, she's in her iconic Ariana Grande hair, this big ass ponytail. Her outfits are.
They slay.
They slay. They are the best part of the show. She says, quote, I will destroy your happiness if it is the last thing I do. That is also her thing.
Now we cut to Henry. Now we're in Boston.
Present day.
Present day. He's reading a storybook on a bus. Introduced two other key players. Henry's book with the title. It's called Once Upon a Time. And his scarf. It's red and gray striped. It's iconic. He's the moment.
It's fashion. So then we cut to Emma. And Emma is on a date, and it's her birthday. It's not important, but it's also incredibly important that she's wearing a hot pink bodycon dress.
She is fashion. She's the moment.
She is sexy.
She is sexy.
So then we learn that she's a bail bonds person. She has no friends, no family, very large trust issues, but she's a badass.
The classic YA combination, honestly. So Emma's having a little sad party for herself. Henry shows up at her door. Turns out he's her kid that she gave up for adoption 11 years ago.
Yeah.
It wasn't love. It wasn't love. Back in Magic Land, Snow White is now pregnant. Snow says that she, Regina, poisoned an apple because she thought I was prettier than her. That's only in the pilot. They changed the backstory for the rest of the show.
So Snow and Charming are worried about her threat from the wedding to potentially hurt their unborn child. So they visit Rumpelstiltskin. Rumpelstiltskin, point to him.
Where is he? Oh, he's over here.
Rumpelstiltskin is the most powerful and dangerous person in this realm. He is currently in prison. He has gold skin.
So kind of how he is.
It's just who he is. He's kind of lizard-like.
He's just kind of a lizard man.
So they go to him, even though they know they literally locked him up because they're so concerned for their child.
Mm-hmm. His little quote that he has is all magic comes with a price. He likes to make deals. Snow makes a deal with him. Probably inadvisable. He gives them information about Regina's threat and how to protect their child. And in exchange, she tells him the name of their unborn child. We learn that the curse Regina is going to enact is going to be a prison of time. And we learn that their child will be the savior. That she will ultimately be the one to break the curse. They say, get the child to safety, and on its 28th birthday, the child will return. The child will find you. And then we learn that Snow White and Prince Charming's child is who? It's Emma.
Emma!
Emma!
It was love. Okay. Back present day. Henry is explaining why he came and found Emma and that he wants her to come home with him. If there's one thing about Henry, it's that he's not gonna be all vague and mm-mm. indirect. Mm-mm. He's getting straight to the point. He mm-hmm. full on says, fairy tales are real and actually you're from one. And so then he says that everybody in Storybrooke, where he's from, are fairy tale characters.
And Emma's like, okay.
And then she says, just because you believe something, that doesn't make it true. And he says, that's exactly what makes it true.
Emma drives Henry back to Storybrooke.
Storybrooke.
He says, the people in town can't leave or bad things will happen to them. The town is frozen in time, and the clock tower is literally frozen at 8:15.
Then we're in town. When they get out of the car, who's there but Archie? He is Henry's therapist. And then Henry immediately goes, he's Jiminy Cricket.
We're back in the Enchanted Forest. You see Snow and Charming's like advisory council or something. We meet the Blue Fairy. She tells them of a magic enchanted tree that can ward off any curse if it's hollowed out, but can only protect one person. We also meet Geppetto and Pinocchio.
There's no card for Pinocchio.
He's unimportant. Geppetto will fashion the tree into a wardrobe, and the plan is for Snow White to go through without Charming. And so that she can raise Emma and guide her in this new world without magic.
Back in Storybrooke. Henry's mom is the mayor of Storybrooke. Guess who it is? It's Regina. Regina is his adopted mother.
And she's the mayor.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, that's a line.
We got a big line, people.
It wasn't love. It wasn't love. It was a perfect feeling.
Henry says, she doesn't love me. She only pretends to. And we also meet Graham. Graham, and he's the sheriff. Look at him.
We learn that Henry's father doesn't know about him and is no longer in Emma's life.
Emma tries to leave town and is like, okay, kid, I dropped you off. Now I gotta go. But then she sees a wolf in the road, and then she swerves into the town sign.
In the Enchanted Forest, the curse has arrived, but uh-oh, SpaghettiOs.
Don't do that.
Snow's gone into labor.
And then we meet Mary Margaret Blanchard, who is Snow White. She's an elementary school teacher.
It wasn't
yada 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 yada.
We learn that Mary Margaret was the one to give the book to Henry because
she wanted to give him hope.
Oh yeah, it was really sweet. But then Regina's like takes that as a personal insult. And
that's her thing. Back in the Enchanted Forest, the wardrobe is finished, but it's too late to put Snow White in there because she's like halfway to having a baby. So she has to give birth to Emma, and they decide to put Emma in the wardrobe alone. And Snow says, we have to give her her best chance, which is the same thing that Emma says about Henry and her decision to give him up for adoption.
While the curse is happening, the evil queen's like army is like taking over the castle. So Charming is fighting off all the guards while holding his newborn child to the and bringing her to the wardrobe. And then we have a dead alert. But it's not really a dead alert.
Dead alert, but spoiler, he's not dead. Charming dies.
After putting Emma into the wardrobe. Boy.
So, like, he's dead, but, like, he's not
dead. He's not. He's momentarily dead.
That's, like, another...
Because the curse just kind of then happens.
Snow finds Charming's dead body. Heartbreaking. Regina finds them, is, like, taunting them. And then the curse arrives.
And then Snow asks, where are we going?
Regina's like, somewhere horrible, absolutely horrible, a place where the only happy ending will be mine.
So then back in Storybrooke, Regina's immediately hostile to Emma. She's like really insecure about Emma being there.
So Regina takes Henry's book because she doesn't like that he's getting ideas, thinking that she's the evil queen.
Mary Margaret, she volunteers at the hospital in her free time because what else is she gonna do because she's Mary Margaret? A little zoom out and we see that, who is it in a coma as John Doe?
It's him. He's there.
And
he's alive.
He's like a big room all to himself,
but he's in a coma. Emma decides to stay in Storybrooke for a week. She gets a room at Granny's. We meet Granny and Ruby. They have like a little bed and breakfast and a restaurant. Then we also meet Mr. Gold, who is Rumpelstiltskin. He has normal skin. And he basically owns the entire town and everyone is constantly owing him rent. He's a bad landlord.
The episode ends and the last scene is that when Emma decides to stay, The clock moves
to 8:16. Time moves forward. It's legendary.
Next episode. What is it called?
I don't remember. The thing you... Are we saying it together?
No.
Episode 2 is The Thing You Love Most.
Regina knocks on Emma's hotel room, at Granny's and brings her a basket of Honey Crisps from her tree that she has in her backyard. And they are literally not Honey Crisps at all. They are the darkest red apples ever. And she's like, Honey Crisps are the most, like, they stand through the most winters and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, girl, those aren't Honey Crisps.
I like that this bothers you so much.
It does.
Once again, Regina threatens Emma because what else does she do? Flashback to Regina in the Enchanted Forest before the curse. She's like talking about how she wants to get revenge on Snow. Revenge for what? We don't know. There's a man in the mirror, magic mirror, and her dad, who like seems like her butler or something. It's a weird dynamic that they have.
It wasn't love.
We find out that the curse is called the Dark Curse and she traded it away, but she's gonna snatch it back from Maleficent.
There she is.
She traded the Dark Curse for Maleficent's sleeping curse that Regina had used to poison Snow.
Regina goes to Maleficent in her forbidden fortress. Maleficent mentioned something about Regina's dead love and how that Snow ruined it. Keep that in the back of your mind.
Regina says, the only comfort for me is Snow White's suffering.
She's really got a one-track mind. Regina says that Maleficent is her only friend. So they got issues.
We know that Maleficent didn't make the curse, and neither did Regina. So we don't...
So it's like, who made it?
We don't know who made it yet.
Who made it?
So then Regina tries to enact the curse with a bunch of magician's hairs, and then the heart of her dead horse. But it doesn't work, and then she kills a gnome.
Then we learn the man in the mirror, the magic mirror man, is the newspaper man, Sidney Glass. He basically serves as Regina's propaganda machine, usually to slander Emma. He says that Emma got into some trouble when she was a kid, but the details are locked up pretty tight.
That won't come out for a really long time.
A really long time. And then also...
the attitude here.
He says that Emma doesn't like to sit still, that she's moved around a lot.
So then Henry introduces this idea of Operation Cobra, and it's his plan to break the curse. And then he like pitches that to Emma, and she participates because he's important to her, and she wants to be in his life, but she doesn't actually believe in the curse.
So then Regina does a little like scheme. She gets Archie to give Emma Henry's like therapist file, literally a HIPAA violation. And then she gets Graham to arrest Emma for stealing the file, you know, sets her up to get arrested. But it's okay because Mary Margaret bails her out.
Once Emma's out, she chops down Regina's Honeycrisp apple tree in her backyard to show that she'll, like, fight back and she's not just gonna, like, let Regina do this to her.
Then Regina gets Emma kicked out of Granny's Inn because Granny has a policy that people can't say if they have a criminal record.
Then Regina places Henry in the exact position to overhear Emma telling Regina why she thinks Henry is crazy and delusional, even though those are the exact words that Archie told Emma not to use. And it's just so fucked up that Regina did that. Like, you're just hurting Henry to get Emma to leave, which is not a very good mom thing to do.
But Emma makes it up to Henry by explaining that she was just kind of covering up suspicions of Operation Cobra, so they're all good.
We learn that Henry tore out the last 3 pages of the book to hide from Regina.
Regina.
And it's the pages where you find out that Emma is Snow and Charming's daughter, and that therefore she is the savior, which is keeping that knowledge from Regina.
Okay, back in Enchanted Forest, Regina finds out that Rumple made the curse, big surprise, and she she visits him in jail. She wants Rumple to like help her with the curse, figure out why it didn't work. His conditions are that in the like cursed land, he wants to be rich, and he wants her to do whatever he wants if he says please. And she's like, okay, fine, you're not gonna remember anyway. So then Rumple tells her that her beloved steed wasn't enough. She needs to kill something that she loved more. And he says, you know what you love, now kill it.
Then Regina does this thing where she leads her dad on to believe that she's like over revenge and she's not gonna enact this curse anymore. But then when she's hugging him, she kills him to get his heart.
So dead alert. And then, yeah, we also learned that his name is Henry. So Regina named Henry after her dad, Henry. But he's dead. And she killed him.
It wasn't love.
He's dead. R.I.P. So now she has a sufficient heart to enact the curse. So she does.
So that's how the episode ends. It's like the prequel to the Enchanted Forest in the first episode.
Yeah.
So basically, like, the Enchanted Forest in these episodes, it's just like random things from different pieces of time. But then the storybook timeline is the one that goes chronologically.
Yeah. Also in this episode, we find out that Mr. Gold procured Henry for her, for Regina in the new realm. So it's not a coincidence that Regina got the Savior's son.
Episode 3.
Okay, Snowfall.
I'll say episode...
okay.
Why are you always here interrupting me as if I'm like a teleprompter?
Episode 3. Snowfalls.
Charming is engaged to another woman.
Gasp.
And it's Princess Abigail. Her outfit is what I would like to say, sleigh out of sleigh. And they're just in the carriage, but then she's looking like gorgeous. She's at the Met Gala. The carriage is getting ambushed by a bandit. And guess who it is? It's Snow White. And Charming rides after the thief. And that's giving YA trope. So then she hits him in the face with a rock to escape. And then he's like, I will always find you. But it's like angry this time.
It was
3. Mary Margaret, we're in the storybook now, is on a date at Granny's with Dr. Whale. Also, we also call him Dr. Krusty.
Because he's crusty.
He's just, his behavior is constantly crusty.
The way he looks at people is crusty.
Oh my god. The entire date, he's just staring at Ruby's butt. She's a waitress at Granny's. And so, yeah, part of Snow's curse is being unable to find love in Storybrooke. We got a recurrence of Emma's trust issues when Mary Margaret offers to let Emma move into her spare room. And Emma's like, I'm not the roommate type. I do better on my own. Emma convinces Mary Margaret to read to John Doe, Mr. Charming, in his coma. And so Mary Margaret reads their love story from Henry's book. But then, while she's reading, he grabs her hands, and it's low-key a jump scare. Like, it's kind of scary.
It's terrifying.
She's like, ooh. So Mary Margaret tells Dr. Krusty, but he gaslights her, says there's no brain activity, she's imagining things. But then he calls Regina. He's like, there was a fluctuation in the John Doe's brain activity. So...
it was
another one.
Oh god, your elbow.
I know. Don't pay attention. So then he wakes up and he escapes the hospital. He goes out into the woods. So while they're like trying to figure out where he went, we see Sleepy, whose name is Walter, and Grumpy, whose name is Leroy. They work at the hospital. They're the security guy and the janitor, respectively. Graham tracks him through the woods.
It's hot. Why did you say that?
Because these are things that you said.
You don't think Graham's hot? We learn that Snow White is a fugitive in the Queensland. And fugitive Snow is the most attractive version. It's not, you can't dispute that. Charming catches Snow in a trap he set in the woods. Part of the jewels that she stole was his mother's engagement ring, and he wants it back, but then she sold it to some trolls, so he makes her help him get it back, or he'll turn her into the queen. But the tension in this episode, it's like enemies to lovers, basically. Snow White is kind of giving the Emma vibes of like, it's best to be alone so that no one can hurt you at this moment. And then when like they're starting to talk about Regina, she says, she blames me for ruining her life. And then he asks, did you? And she says, yes. So keep that in your mind. The two of them go to the troll bridge, but are attacked by trolls.
Who would have thought?
There's this dark fairy dust that basically like makes people evaporate. But she was saving to use that on Regina, but then she uses it on the trolls to save Charming.
They find Mr. Charming, Mr. John Doe, in the river by the toll bridge, which someone has graffitied to say troll bridge. Mary Bargrate gives him some very inaccurate CPR.
It's like so bad. It's so
it
bad.
It just turns into her kissing him.
It was just so bad.
They're back in the hospital. They bring him back. Apparently Regina is Charming's emergency contact. His name is David Nolan. And then Princess Abigail shows up, but she's named Catherine, and she's David's wife. So now he's got two wives.
Think you can have a bunch of wives?
You get one wife.
That's the way the world works. So then, Snow and Charming, they part ways. She tries on his wedding ring when they get like the jewels back, and it's kind of like, what? And then they both look back as they leave, and that literally means that they're in love.
And when you look back when you leave, that means you're in love.
And then we also find out that like Mary Margaret in Storybrooke has his wedding ring on.
Mm-hmm. It was messy five.
And then Emma takes Mary Margaret's spare room.
Aww. So she's opening so up. She's opening up.
She has a friend.
Episode 4.
The Price of Gold. We meet Cinderella.
She's right here.
She's right there. And her stepfamily, we start her story after they've gone off to the ball and she's all sad school. Her fairy godmother shows up and is going to transform her, do some magic, but oops, Rumpelstiltskin kills her. And takes her magic wand. Cinderella promises him anything he wants if he'll help her change her life. Never say those words,
girl.
Rumpelstiltskin. Never, what? ever. Yeah, it's a big All Magic Comes With a Price episode. She signs a huge contract.
It's ginormous. And she's just
she
like,
didn't read
okay.
It.
What?
And I think it's just kind of funny that he like kind of tosses it over his shoulder and she like signs it
on
his
butt.
Oh my
god, yeah. Rumpelstiltskin, truly, I mean, he's evil, but he is the funniest character ever.
Yeah.
He's
his
so funny.
Comedy. Okay. Robert Carlyle.
Robert Carlyle is such a good actor. You might know him as the person who always plays Hitler and things.
What?
But that's because he's a good actor.
Like, literally, he's objectively the best part of this show.
Oh, no, he gives his all in this show.
Oh, my God.
And some of these actors, I swear, they can't act. I'm sorry, babe.
But Mr. Sir can.
Yeah.
And he does. Mm-hmm.
So then, in Storybrooke, Graham offers Emma a job as deputy, but she turns it down. She has a fear of commitment. So we learn that Tallahassee holds some kind of importance for Emma. Remember that for next season.
Keep that in your mind.
So Cinderella turns out to be Ashley Boyd in Storybrooke, and she's pregnant and alone. Emma gives her a pep talk about changing her life and how she has control over her life. But then she takes that a little bit weirdly, and she breaks into Gold's pawn shop and steals something.
Yeah, by the way, Mr. Gold owns a pawn shop.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think we mentioned that.
Regina has a lot of adoptive mother insecurity. That's a big trend. Pretty much for the show.
Basically, it's her driving force, like her
for
motivation season for season one.
Season
that
one.
She's insecure about Emma being back in Henry's life.
But then Gold comes to Emma to track down Ashley because she's stolen something precious from him. But he doesn't want to go to the police because he doesn't want Ashley to go to jail. You know, aww. he's so nice.
He's just like a prison abolitionist. So then Cinderella's story proceeds as we would expect. You know, she goes to the ball, she meets the prince, they fall in love, they get married. At the wedding, there's a Snow and Charming cameo. It's super fun, they're friends. But then Rumpelstiltskin shows up at the wedding.
Move your head. He's over here.
And he's like, I'm gonna cash in on my favor that you owe me. And surprise, surprise, he wants her firstborn child.
It's almost like the OG plot.
It's like the OG plot of Rumpelstiltskin, but in this show, it's like not explained why he wants the baby.
He
don't
really makes deals just for the fun of it. That
like
ruin
like,
other people's
I'm
lives.
I'm out here to cause some chaos, ruin some people's lives. So then Cinderella's husband is named Thomas. He's like generally unimportant, but he's a really good husband.
Emma tracks down Ashley's ex-boyfriend for help finding Ashley. And he's this really wealthy guy living with his dad. And the boyfriend, his name is Sean in this world, seems concerned and like he wants to help, but his dad stops him. Then we learn that Ashley made a deal with Gold to sell the baby to him. So.
Cinderella and her husband, plus Snow and Charming, create this plan to trick Rumpelstiltskin and capture him once and for all. And they convert the dwarf mines into his prison cell that we see him in
later.
So Cinderella gets Rumpelstiltskin to sign a new contract with an enchanted quill that renders him immobile, and they capture him. And they're like, his strength is also his weakness. His deals. He can't resist making them. So true. But then, like, Rumpelstiltskin, he, like, seems to know that she's trying to trick him, but he kind of goes along with it anyway.
We don't know why, though.
I don't know. And so he, like, makes a threat about he'll find a way to get her baby, just like Han. After Rumpel's locked up, Thomas, her husband, just disappears.
It's like Cinderella learning the lesson of like
paying the price of magic.
Ashley tries to leave for Boston, but crashes on the side of the road because they literally can't leave town.
So. It's like when Henry says they can't leave or bad things will happen. Like, bad things will literally happen. Like, they always crash.
They
can't leave.
She literally crashed her car and then she's in labor.
Uh-oh.
Henry realizes that Emma is the only one who can leave Storybrooke, but she's deciding to stay because she wants to put down roots for Henry. Isn't that cute? Mr. Gold tries to scare Emma into compliance, but she's a feisty one. She makes a deal with him.
What?
To let Ashley keep the baby in exchange for Emma owing him a favor, which is not...
not the best idea.
Not the best idea. And then Emma also chooses to take the sheriff's deputy job.
And then, just a little side note. The episode
ends with this. Regina tells Henry that she has weekly city council meetings, but she's just having sex with Graham. Icky.
Yeah, vibes. Literally, like, I think she leaves Henry home alone, which he's 11, so that she can go off and just have sex with Graham. Like, every week.
Every week. Consistently.
Bam.
Oh god, this episode.
Oh.
Episode 15.
Nope.
Episode 5.
That still small voice.
This one's a real one, guys. In Fairytale Land, we meet a family of puppeteers, but they just perform so that their son can pickpocket money from the audience members when they're watching the show. And then we find out that it's Jiminy. And
Cricket. He's not a cricket.
He's not a cricket. He looks like Archie. And then adult Jiminy is still doing it, and he hates it, and he interacts with a sweet little boy about crickets.
And then in Storybrooke, Henry mentions that there are no crickets in Storybrooke. And that's just like a thing. So Emma's starting as deputy sheriff, you know, her and Graham are flirting, it's a little flirty. Regina isn't happy. She wants Graham to pick someone else, but he's like, that's not how bureaucracy works. And then, bam, there's an explosion. The mine tunnel collapse.
It's not like nobody gets hurt in this explosion.
Regina wants to pave it over, but Henry thinks that she's trying to hide something down there. And so then Archie tries to tell Regina to like chill out. And then she threatens to fire him.
Because she's like, I don't think your therapy is actually working for Henry. And I'm like, girl, you're the reason it's happening. Oh.
Right, because like it's just not yielding the results that she wants to be able to control Henry. So then she just like casually threatens to make Archie homeless and kind of like exile him from town. Then, because Archie doesn't want to be out on the streets, he tells Henry that he's delusional and it's psychosis. So,
like, that's like Archie went to level 1,000
of unethical psychology. We learn that Archie and Marco, who is Geppetto, are besties. Emma then stands up to Archie about not taking away Henry's fantasy because that's literally exactly what he told her not to do, but then he, like, crushed his dreams, basically, and she's like, what the fuck? Meanwhile, Mary, Margaret, and David are bonding in the hospital. It's called chemistry.
Literally a definition of chemistry.
Henry then goes into the abandoned, crumbling mine, and Archie ends up getting trapped down there with him, which is like, okay.
So that's how that.
We're doing this for what?
In the Enchanted Forest, Jiminy goes to Rumpel to help him be free of his parents. And so then he gives him a little potion that's like, these will get rid of him. They meet this super nice couple that Jiminy's family deceives. Like, they talk about this disease and then they're like, we have the cure though, the only antidote. It's like so stupid.
They're basically the snake oil salesman of the Enchanted Forest.
Jiminy's parents, pure evil, switch the murder potion that he got from Rumpel with the stuff they give to the couple. Well, they don't even know what the murder potion does. They don't know that's a murder potion, but they're like, let's switch it. Then the nice couple turns into puppets. And Jiminy, like, has to live with this guilt that he turned these really sweet people into puppets. And it gets worse. How could it get worse? Because that little boy that Jiminy bonded with before, yeah, those were his parents.
Yeah, it's no good. When we talk about moments that, like, altered your brain chemistry as a child, this was one of them for me.
Jiminy then, like, is so distraught. He wishes to the Blue Fairy to bring the parents back. She can't. That's not how magic works. But then he wishes to turn into a cricket so he can help the little boy who ends up being Geppetto.
Regina and Emma put aside their issues for the first time for Henry's sake because, you know, he's trapped in the mine. They're trying to figure out how to, like, get them out of the mine. So then Emma gets Henry and Archie from the mine. Archie almost falls to his death, no big deal. Archie stands up to and absolutely owns Regina. And then while all that's happening, David and Mary Margaret are getting closer. He's lying to Catherine about, like, what he's remembering. from his coma, because he still has, like, literally zero memories. And he says to Mary Margaret, like, you're the only thing that feels right. And they're about to kiss, but then Catherine's there. And so Mary Margaret resigns from being a hospital volunteer because she knows that she's developing feelings for David, and she's, like, actually the mature one in this whole situation. Now there are crickets chirping in Storybrooke, and we see that the puppet parents are kept in Gold's pawn shop. And then at the end, Regina drops these glass shards into the mine, and then we see that Snow's casket from the first episode is down there.
Yeah.
It's in the mine. So she really was hiding something in the mine.
Ah! It's okay. Almost like Henry's been right. What?
Do you see those clips from Lollapalooza of Charlie XCX?
No.
During the introduction to Vroom Vroom?
No.
Just like, you don't know it. We can help you learn it.
Okay.
Let's drive.
Ah! Episode 6.
The Shepherd.
David Nolan is back at the Nolan house. Henry says that the curse hasn't been able to replace his memories with fake ones, so they need to jog his memory of the Enchanted Forest.
It's like, basically, he has no memories, so if they can jog his memories of the Enchanted Forest, they can, like, prevent him from having his cursed memories.
Yes.
Is the thought process.
Yes. Mm. Catherine and Regina are, like, friends. So, that's something. David shows up to Mary Margaret's place instead of his own welcome home party, and is talking about how his marriage and life doesn't feel right, but Mary Margaret's like, you need to leave.
Now we're in the Enchanted Forest, and we see Charming, named James, kill someone, this, like, guy, as a test to prove that he can kill a dragon that is plaguing King Midas's kingdom, and King George, who is James's father, wants Midas's gold.
King Midas, like, from Greek mythology.
King Midas as in, like, boop, gold. King Midas makes a little comment about, like, remember what happened to Frederick when a guy is taking off his, like, protective glove gold glove. So keep that in your mind. But then the guy that James killed wasn't actually dead, and so he, like, spears him, basically, through the chest. And so, dead alert, Prince James.
He's dead.
Which,
like, what? What? That's Prince Charming.
So it's like, huh, what's going on here?
But then
we learn that Rumpelstiltskin.
You gotta move when you say Rumpelstiltskin.
Gave James to King George in a deal when King George and his wife couldn't conceive. So, George adopted James.
So it's not Prince Charming. James is not Prince Charming.
But they are identical. Well, turns out that James has a twin brother, and he's a shepherd, and his name is David.
It wasn't love.
So Rumpelstiltskin goes to David, like, their farm.
King George needs another one.
And, like, King George needs you. David learns that he had a twin brother named James, that they're parents basically, like, traded him away to save their farm. David's mother is named Ruth. She's a legend.
She is a legend.
We love her.
It wasn't love. It wasn't love. It was a perfect illusion.
Okay, so if you're confused, which, understandable, basically, so Ruth is the mother of both James and David.
They're twins.
Right after they were born, Ruth made a deal with Rumpelstiltskin to give James to King George.
But they would still have David.
But they still had David to save their farm. Then when James dies, Rumpelstiltskin goes back to Ruth and is like, we need David for King George because otherwise, like, they need someone to kill the dragon. George still wants Midas's money. David agrees to play the part of James and go and kill the dragon.
Okay.
To, again, save his mother and save their farm.
It wasn't love.
So that's the recap.
We're back in Storybrooke, and David and Catherine kiss, and it is dull. It's dull. And he literally says to her face, this isn't right. We also learn that Dr. Whale asks out Mary Margaret again. And then David leaves Catherine. And then Regina blames Mary Margaret for David leaving her, even though she literally didn't even know what was going on.
Okay. Anyways, Shepherd David somehow kills the dragon with absolutely zero combat experience. Abigail is actually Midas's daughter, and so he gives her hand in marriage to David because he killed the dragon. And then King George basically threatens to kill Ruth and everyone he loves to, like, force David to marry her.
It wasn't love. It wasn't love.
Yeah, so now David basically is James permanently. Yeah, and so then David has to go back to, like, tell his mom. Then we get the heartbreaking moment where he's like, I didn't come here for advice, mother. I came here to say goodbye. And then Ruth gives him the ring.
Regina gives David directions that go past the pawn shop. He goes in there and he sees the windmill spinning that's in the pawn shop, and it jogs his fake memory.
She knew what she was doing.
Okay, so then David totally led Mary Margaret on that he wanted to be with her, but then he ends up going back. You're not pointing.
I'm reminiscing.
But then he ends up going back to Catherine because he thinks that he should at least, like, give it a try now that he remembers stuff.
Which, like, fair. Like, you decided this after you literally told Mary Margaret that you wanted to be with her.
Oh, wait, we need to clarify that this is, like, a love marriage.
It wasn't love.
Okay. David says that he should at least give it a try with Catherine. So then he, like, he's just kind of being a dick. Then there's this little flirty moment with Mary Margaret and Dr. Whale. So this is an ending.
Episode ends with Enchanted Forest David and Abigail in the carriage. They're on their
with
way.
With her sleigh out of sleigh outfit.
With her sleigh out of sleigh outfit. They're, like, getting ready to get married. And he says, I thought we might take the scenic route. And that's basically, like, the lead into
Snowfalls,
Bandit Snow. We see how it goes. Okay, but I need to crack my back.
No, wait, what? No.
This episode causes Addie great heartbreak.
Episode 7.
The heart is a lonely hunter. Graham, if you will recall, the last time we saw Graham, he, you know, has, like, weekly sex with Regina, and Emma at some point found out about it. And so now they're, like, having a conversation about that. She's just kind of grossed out. He says that he doesn't feel anything. He, like...
Like, at all. Like,
period. At all. He's just like, I...
Yeah.
Graham just, like, throws a dart at her, then kisses her. But then when he kisses her, he, like, sees in his head a wolf with a red eye, which then leads us to think that kissing Emma brings back pre-cursed memories.
So Graham is starting to have a crisis. We have another dead alert, and it's Snow's dad. His name is King Leopold.
It wasn't love. It wasn't.
Now we have two dead dads.
R.I.P.
And Regina. Oh, I meant to add that one too.
It wasn't love.
He's dead. He's Snow's dad. And obviously Regina is married to him. But Regina now plans to kill Snow. Regina, after he dies, is all, like, empathetic and compassionate. She's comforting Snow. Very fake. We learn that Regina killed the king, but didn't kill Snow because the kingdom is still loyal to Snow and that they would turn on Regina. And then she says, they don't know the wretchedness in her as I do. They don't know what she did to me. So it's all bubbling up, people. Huntsmen have no heart and are adept at murder, in Regina's words. But then it, like, cuts to the huntsman, who is Graham in the Enchanted Forest. And he literally thanks each animal he kills and then cries for them. And then people, like, are mean to him for, like, having emotions and being a huntsman. It's so toxic. It's giving toxic masculinity. And then we see the same wolf, like, the wolf that the huntsman has is the same wolf that Graham is seeing in his vision.
Womp womp. Then Graham...
Wait, should we add, like, a pink line?
Oh.
I just realized.
Yes.
It wasn't love. I'm so scared.
So then Regina realizes that Graham is starting to remember pre-curse things. Graham sees the wolf, like, literally in town, like, physically in town. So then Graham goes a little psychotic. He's like running through the woods chasing the wolf. He sees gold in the woods.
When you say gold?
Gold says that he thinks that dreams are memories from another life. Okay. So he's like burying something, so suspicious. Like, sir, what are you doing here? Graham and the wolf bond, and he remembers more, including a vision with Snow White, so he goes to Mary Margaret about it.
Back in the Enchanted Forest, the evil queen, Regina, wants a huntsman to kill Snow because she wants someone without compassion. And also, he was raised by wolves. The only thing that the huntsman wanted in return was to outlaw the killing of wolves. This man, Snow, and the huntsman are walking through the woods, and then she realizes what he's there to do, so she starts running away. But then she stops running to write a letter to Regina. And then when the huntsman finds her, he doesn't kill her. He makes her a little safety whistle? Question mark.
So then Graham realizes that he doesn't remember when he met anyone in town. Ooh. And like, no one in town remembers when they met anyone. It's all just like a fog. But then Graham like actually realizes it. So then he reviews the contents of the book with Henry. And he believes that he needs to follow the wolf to the vault to find his heart. So, like, now he believes in the curse. Emma thinks he sounds insane, but they see the wolf. They break into Regina's mausoleum to look for Graham's heart.
Snow's letter to Regina is so genuine about, like, I'm sorry for whatever I did, blah, 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 blah. But Regina threw it in the fire. But, like, we learn from that Snow betrayed Regina somehow. The drama there.
The drama.
And then the quote is, I shared a secret with her and she couldn't keep it.
We're getting information.
The huntsman in the Enchanted Forest gave Regina an animal heart instead of Snow's. But then when she goes to like put the heart in like
dinner. She has like a wall of hearts.
Yeah. Then the magic door to like where Snow's heart is gonna be doesn't open. So she figured out that it wasn't Snow White's heart. Regina rips his heart out. It doesn't kill him. That's how it works here. A magic person can rip out the heart and just kind of like hold it and then control what they do then. So now Regina controls everything that he does while holding it, which hints to Ram being under Regina's control in Storybrook.
So then Regina in Storybrook finds them like in her mausoleum where her dad is buried. Graham then refuses to go home with her. Then Regina only chooses to hear that Graham is choosing Emma over her. Emma stands up to Regina. Regina fucking socks her in the face. But then we learn that Regina's hearts, her like wall of hearts, is underneath her father's mausoleum. She like has her vault underneath there.
They were right about the mausoleum.
Back at the sheriff's station, Graham and Emma kiss.
It wasn't love. It wasn't love.
Yeah. Emma lets her walls down for exactly 1 second. Graham then remembers all of his memories from before the curse. And we aren't really sure if it's from kissing Emma or from, like, Regina.
Regina's currently at the vault.
In the vault, like, holding his heart.
Graham's heart.
And so, like, the way it's edited, you don't really know which caused it. But he remembers. But then Regina crushes his heart. So, dead alert.
It was. This is the hardest one to do for me. I think it's harder than any other part of it. What?
Oh, never mind. Shut the fuck up.
Oh my god. Yeah, and Graham dies literally right in front of Emma.
Oh my god.
Right after they kiss. As if Emma doesn't have enough trauma. And then another like random detail from this episode is that Mary Margaret and Dr. Whale had a one-night stand. So there's
so
that.
We're adding a line.
It wasn't love.
The way that the line to Dr. Whale is like ingrained with their family lines is so sick. so sick.
It wasn't love. It wasn't.
This is such a disgusting line to have on the family tree. Anyways.
The fact that he's part of the family.
He's part of the family now.
Aw. So that's the episode.
Episode 8.
Desperate Souls. We got Rumpelstiltskin. He's a poor spinner, and he has normal skin. He has a son named Balefire.
It wasn't love.
Rumpelstiltskin is trying to protect Balefire from being drafted into the Ogre Wars.
The Ogre Wars are like the biggest thing.
It's just like a thing.
It's like always happening.
There's constantly the war, and it's the Ogre War. They introduce the concept of the Dark One. He's like this all-powerful magical being.
In Storybrook, Gold tells Emma that she's been automatically promoted to sheriff because she's been acting sheriff for 2 weeks. It's like the rule. Henry wants a break from Operation Cobra because he doesn't want anybody else, especially Emma, to get hurt by messing with the curse, which is what Graham did. So, and
he's dead.
Shut up. And Henry says, good loses, good always loses, because good has to play fair, evil doesn't. Isn't that awful? Regina blocks Emma from being sheriff by promoting Sydney Glass. And then fires her.
Girl,
you thought he would be a good sheriff?
He worked at the newspaper.
But then they're like, no, you can't just like do that. People are allowed to vote in like if there are multiple candidates. So Gold and Emma team up. To oppose Regina.
So then Rumpel takes his son. They like run away so that Bay does not get, like, drafted into the war. He, like, passes a poor man. Rumpel gives him some money. They run into the soldiers that are, like, taking all the kids. And we learn that Rumpelstiltskin ran from the war when he was a soldier and returned to a, quote, wife who could not bear the sight of him. The soldiers, like, make Rumpel kiss his boot.
In exchange for them not taking Bay. It's, like, just pure humiliation.
Humiliation and showing how, like, Rumpelstiltskin is a coward and, like, doesn't have any power. And the poor man that Rumpel gave money to, like, helps them home. Then this old man tells Rumpelstiltskin that the Dark One is enslaved by whoever wields this magical dagger, which reads the true name of the Dark One. And then he encourages Rumpelstiltskin to steal the dagger so that he can control the Dark One himself. Or kill the Dark One with the dagger, and then you, like, can take the power for yourself and you become the Dark One. Killing the Dark One is presented as, like, the alternative option because Rumpel is too scared to just control the Dark One, which I find very bizarre.
The way that they're doing it is, like, Rumpelstiltskin, it's like, you have his name, you have his power. So that's kind of, like, what the dagger signifies in the story of Rumpelstiltskin. So Sydney writes an article, Sydney Glass, exposing that Emma had Henry while she was in jail. But those records were supposed to be sealed. So shady stuff is going on. Regina is acting like exposing this information is supposed to be helping Henry and, like, he should know.
It's like, how do you think that, like, giving out all this, like, negative information about his birth mother is gonna make, like, your relationship better?
So Emma goes to confront Regina, but then there's a fire in City Hall. And Emma saves Regina. And then when they, like, take pictures of the news and everything, Emma's the hero. But it turns out that Gold set the fire to give Emma something special in the election, which was like, dude, what? So then Mary Margaret and David run into each other on opposing sides of the election. And then David, like, works at the animal shelter now. The sheriff debate is here. And who's the moderator? It's Archie, of course. Emma fears that if she's not a hero, then she doesn't have a place in Henry's life. So she wants to win so that she can show Henry that, so that she can show Henry that good can win.
Van Rumpel steal the Dark One's dagger. We learn the Dark One is named Zoso. Then Bay asks Rumpel to just step away from the magic and the power, that they don't need it. They don't need to kill the Dark One. Rumpel, does he listen? No. This will not be the last time that this happens. So then Rumpel just, like, kills the Dark One. And it turns out the Dark One is the poor man from earlier who had encouraged him to kill the Dark One in the first place.
What?
And so then Zoso, the, like, former Dark One, says, looks like you made a deal you didn't understand. I don't...
Oh my god.
I don't think you're gonna do that again.
It's also hinting that, like, Zoso doesn't actually... He was trying to get out of it. Like, he didn't, like...
Yeah.
The curse of being the Dark One. So that's, like, foreshadowing.
From this life.
Foreshadowing. Emma admits that Gold set the fire to make her look like a hero. And she, like, says that to everybody.
At the debate.
So then she's kind of like, okay, I lost, right? Because she's, like, admitting that happened. And then Henry believes in Operation Cobra and heroes again because of Emma. But then actually Emma wins the election because the town likes that somebody will stand up to Mr. Gold, because as you know, Mr. Gold literally owns every building in the town. Gold apparently planned for Emma to stand up to him. He plans out every single detail of everything. He wanted her to be the sheriff for the purpose of eventually paying him back the favor she owes. So that's why he was helping her in the first place.
Yeah, and so then Rumpelstiltskin, now the Dark One, now with his gold skin, starts killing all the soldiers who are trying to take Bay away. Very evil of him. But he's protecting his son. You know, he says he's no longer scared.
Episode 9.
True North. We meet Ava and Nicholas, who are a brother and sister. They're stealing food and toiletries from a convenience store. They frame Henry.
Side note.
Turns out that Sneezy owns the convenience store, or at least works there.
The dwarves are just, like, everywhere in this world. Like, they do, like, 4,000 things.
They're just, like, workers. So, yeah, then Emma comes, because, you know, she's sheriff. She drops them off at home. But they were lying about where they live. Turns out that their mother died a few years ago, so they don't have any parents and they've been on their own. Emma doesn't report them to social services because she wants to try and find their father so that they can stay together, because Emma grew up in the foster care system and she, like, doesn't want them to end up in foster care. But then Regina reports them to social services because, of course,
She did.
So Emma's now supposed to take them to two different group homes in Boston.
No.
No, thank you.
Ava and Nicholas turn out to be Hansel and Gretel, and they're out gathering wood, and their father comes and gives them his compass to find their way back to him, but then he isn't there when they return. And then they're almost run over by the queen's horses. Regina captures them with, like, roots. She, like...
Magic.
But she likes their bravery, so she decides to help them find their father if they retrieve something for her from the blind witch. Regina takes them to the witch's house, which only children can enter, and tells them not to eat anything. It's a candy house. So then they sneak in. Ava is super determined and definitely older sibling vibes, while crusty little Hansel can't keep his mouth closed, so they get trapped in the house. So then the kids trick her, but it's mostly Gretel, because Hansel is a little bitch, and
he's like 8.
Whatever. Gretel tricks the witch and then ends up cooking the witch, like, in where she was planning to cook the children. So maybe murder is okay.
Yeah, so then Henry asks about his dad.
What?
It's like, what's up? And Emma tells Henry about how they met, kind of vaguely, and then says that he died in a fire. That's a lie.
It's a lie.
It wasn't love.
So that's like what we know about his father for now, except it's a lie, so we don't know. Emma shows Ava and Nicholas her baby blanket, which is the only thing she has from her parents, and they show her their compass that they have from their dad, and so Emma uses the compass to, like, try and locate the dad. She goes to Mr. Gold for help identifying the compass. Turns out he's the one who sold it to the dad. He has this card that, like, says the name of who he sold it to, but then it turns out, like, we can see that the card is blank, so he... Which, it doesn't really have any effect on the story, but it's just kind of like a moment. So then Emma locates the dad in town. He's a mechanic. He didn't know they existed, and he doesn't want to take them. He's like, it's too much responsibility. I can't do it.
Back in the Enchanted Forest, the twins bring the item to Regina, and it's in this satchel. And it turns out it's the poison apple. That's a little later. It has, like, the sleeping curse in it. Okay. Regina wants the children to stay with her and tells them that she can give them everything they want. The twins don't believe her because why? She literally threatened them. And they just want to get back to their dad. Like, that's all they want. Regina is, like, so desperate to have a family of her own. So then when other people have happy families, she's, like, genuinely confused that they would refuse this, like, offer.
But it's like, ma'am, you have the most evil vibes.
Yeah, like, she doesn't realize it.
Like, of course a child doesn't want to stay with you.
Okay, and then it turns out that Regina is the one who kidnapped the dad. It was all premeditated. And then she drops the kids and the father in this infinite forest where they're, like, so far apart so they'll never find each other, basically. Mm-hmm. It's just pure evil. Like, this episode, she's just pure evil.
Emma, like, kind of arranges so that their dad can, like, see them. He decides to take them. Yay, family reunited. Then, Mary Margaret, like, sees Emma's baby blanket. And it seems like she almost remembers something. Because obviously, she would have seen the baby blanket when she had the baby. Emma is about to come clean to Henry about his dad, but she can't stand to disappoint him. And then, there's a new person in town. He comes in on a motorcycle.
But it's like, Emma was the first person to come into town. Forever. So now it's like, oh my god, there's another one.
Like, who is this guy?
Yeah. Mystery.
Yeah.
Episode 10.
7:15 a.m.
So Mary Margaret goes to Granny's every morning at 7:15 a.m. to get a glimpse of David, who is picking up coffee for him and his wife.
Girl. Meanwhile, Snow can't stop thinking about Charlie. So this takes place, like, After snow falls, when they first meet and they part. Snow can't stop thinking about Charming, but obviously he's still engaged to Abigail. And then Red,
they're
friends. It's like, I got you. She's like, go to Rumpelstiltskin. He can help you.
Don't do that.
Bad idea.
You gotta move. And you talk about
Rumpelstiltskin.
Don't point. I'm the pointer.
So then Rumpelstiltskin gives Snow a potion to forget Charming. Like, period. In exchange, she gives him a piece of her hair. Rumpel goes, like, love makes us sick,
haunts our dreams, destroys our days.
It's metal. Yeah, it's pretty metal of him. So Charming's dad, King George, He's a little bitch. Charming sends Snow a love letter via bird, asking her to come to him before he's married if she feels the same way as him so they can be together. Snow goes to see Charming because she loves him, but is caught by a guard. She's locked up. She meets Grumpy in the, like, dungeon. Then we meet Stealthy, who is another dwarf. He comes in and helps them escape, but then, dead alert, Stealthy dies while they're escaping.
So, it, like, there are originally 8 dwarves, actually.
Actually, like, the real version that, like, they don't teach you this in school, that there are actually 8 dwarves.
What's going on?
I don't know.
It was.
So then Snow turns herself into King George to let Grumpy escape.
Mary Margaret saves a bird in the woods, so she goes to the animal hospital. David works there. And then it turns out that David only goes to Granny's at 7:15 a.m. to see Mary Margaret. So it's storming, and then they seek shelter, and then they almost kiss, but then Mary Margaret saw Catherine buying a pregnancy test earlier, so she's like, I know Catherine thinks she's pregnant. And David's all like, huh? But he's still kind of trying to hold her hand. Like, it's buddy. Buddy, you got a wife, sir. You chose the wife. And then David is like, I have these 2 conflicting lives. And it's like, you got like 4, buddy.
David objectively should be having an identity crisis literally all the time.
So then Emma chats up this new guy. You got to point to Emma. Emma chats up with this new guy. And it turns out that his box that he the only thing he has with him on his motorcycle is like this box. And it has a typewriter in it. Then Catherine suggests couple therapy, and David stops going to Granny's in the morning in order to commit to his marriage. Catherine is great. She didn't deserve anything that happens to her in this season. It's like so bad.
Yeah, it's gonna get so much worse.
Yeah.
Now, King George, he forces Snow to tell Charming that she doesn't love him, otherwise King George will kill Charming. He says that love is a disease, sir. Didn't you have a wife? Yeah, so Snow, like, breaks Charming's heart because she doesn't want him to die. And then, like, as she's walking away, like, crying after being forced to break his heart, like, another moment that altered my brain chemistry as a child, I'm not gonna lie. The dwarves take Snow in.
Grumpy. And it's really sweet because they're like, we lost Stealthy, but we gained you. It was very sweet. It was very sweet. Whoa.
Yeah. Grumpy stops her from drinking her Forget Charming potion that she got from Rumple. Charming comes to Red's in search of Snow, but she's not there because he's like, I don't believe that she doesn't love me. Yeah, and so he, like, called the wedding off. And so Grumpy's like, oh, Snow, he called the wedding off. He's not marrying Abigail. You can be together. But, Snow drank the potion, so she doesn't even remember who he is.
Uh-oh. Okay. Mary Margaret and David kiss literally in public.
Like on the sidewalk.
Yeah, they kiss in public. The, like, and it's the same day that David committed to Catherine and to their marriage. Like, boy, what? And then Regina is sitting in her car watching them.
It's honestly creepy. Like, she's just sitting in her car on the street.
I mean, that's all she has to do.
What was she doing? What does she even do as mayor? Regina's daily to-do list is make sure that David and Mary Margaret don't stay together, threaten Emma, be a, like, kind of bad mother to Henry. Anyway.
And slay. Episode 11.
Fruit of the Poisonous Tree.
Sydney Glass.
And what did you just do?
Sydney Glass, in the Enchanted Forest, is the genie of Agrabah, which is Aladdin. King Leopold finds the genie's lamp, but can think of nothing he could possibly wish for. So all he does is he wishes for the genie to be free. His second wish was to give his final wish to the genie, who vows to never use it. That's what he said. The genie, all he wants to do is find true love. So the king invites him to his palace. And the king, King Leopold, is Snow's dad, by the way. Regina is, like, smoking hot right now. So then Jeannie is, like, in love with her.
So now we're in Storybrooke. Sydney is working on an expose on the mayor's office after Regina got him fired from the newspaper, and he wants Emma to help him with it. Then Regina tears down Henry's castle playground where he and Emma would, like, that was kind of their meeting spot. But also Henry had hid his book underneath it, and so now the book is gone. After this happens, Emma calls Sydney, and she's like, I'm in. They meet, Sydney has like a little sneaky outfit, which I think is so funny.
No, it's like, yeah, like Sherlock at home. Like, he has that hat.
The thing that he like has on Regina is that there's $50,000 missing from the city budget. Emma wants to do the investigation by the books, but then she like plants a bug in Regina's office because she's like, this isn't getting us anywhere. Meanwhile, David and Mary Margaret are sneaking around seeing each other.
In the Enchanted Forest, Regina is feeling very unloved and unnoticed by the king. And this is where, like, the who's the fairest of them all is Snow White, is because, like, he's obviously, he loves his daughter so much, but yeah. Then it's kind of like they're not even married.
He, like, doesn't pay attention to her at all.
Yeah. So the genie is very compassionate to her.
Do they kiss at any point?
No.
So the king reads Regina's diary and then learns she's fallen in love with another man, which is implied to be genie. King Leopold, he says, she yearns for a man to love her in a way I never can, but why would she betray me like this? How could she love someone else? You literally just gave
like,
the reason.
Sir, like,
you gave the reason.
What do you mean? You don't pay attention to her.
So the king wants the genie to find the man who she's in love with, but he's not gonna do that, obviously, because he's the man she's in love with. The king locked Regina up. What? Leopold, buddy, Henry the First, the dad, has the genie bring Regina Agrabah Viper. So the genie has the Agrabah Viper, and Regina is going to kill herself. What? But then the genie is like, I'll kill the king for you.
Emma and Sydney, they like follow Regina to where she's meeting Gold to buy land with the $50,000. Someone had cut Emma's brakes. Then Emma breaks into City Hall and she like finds this set of skull keys that Regina has. The alarm is going off and Emma's like, who does the alarm alert? The police. I'm the police.
We'll cut that out.
It turns out that Regina had Sydney watching and taking pictures of Henry and Emma for months. So Emma and Sydney go to confront Regina at the city council meeting about using city funds to build a second home in the woods, which is what they think she's doing. But then she's just like, I'm building a playground for my son Henry and all the children of Storybrooke to have a safe place to play.
She actually says that in a very genuine way. I don't know what you're doing.
She has a very like political tone on.
Oh yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Because it's a city council meeting. The Enchanted Forest, the genie kills the king with the viper. But then it turns out that Regina just used the genie to get him to kill the king because she used the snake from his homeland. Like, she was just doing it so that she wouldn't be faulted with it.
It's just like another setup.
And the genie used his wish that he swore he would never use so that he would never leave her side. But then he gets stuck in the mirror. Like, you literally fell in love with the first woman you saw, and now he's stuck with this woman who does not love him forever.
In a mirror.
Like, he...
And being, like, her slave. Person.
Yeah.
Regina, now after the city council meeting debacle, she's like, you're not gonna be spending any time with Henry. Then it's revealed that Sydney the whole time had just been a spy for Regina and is like continuing to be a spy, and Emma doesn't know. And then it turns out also that the new guy is the one who took the book
from the playground.
So oh my gosh, time for my favorite episode. Like, it does emotional damage.
Yeah, but it's like good emotional damage. Episode 12.
Skin deep.
Very good episode.
Premium episode. So we meet this new, like, royal family. We got Sir Maurice and his daughter, Belle.
It was in love.
And we also meet Gaston.
Gaston.
This also takes place during the Ogres' War, which, again, seems to be never ending.
It's always happening.
Their kingdom is struggling against the Ogres. They seek help from Rumpelstiltskin. We find out Belle is engaged to Gaston.
Yuck.
Rumpel will help them if Belle comes to be his caretaker. Very evil. But Belle agrees to go to save her kingdom. Very hero.
Hi, buddy.
Hi.
Maurice calls Rumpel a beast, and Belle is Belle, so we see where this is going.
Beast.
And yeah, the Rumpelstiltskin humor in this episode is top tier. He's like, congratulations on your little war.
Oh, it's actually kind of good. In Storybrooke, Belle's dad is named Mr. French. Anyways, he owns a flower shop called Game of Thorns. Like, what is this show? And he's late on a loan to Gold. Who isn't? So Gold takes his truck that's like full of flowers. Like, Mr. Gold's house is robbed and he thinks that it's Mr. French. So then Emma's on the case. Emma finds most of his missing things, but he's big mad because there's still one thing missing.
In the Enchanted Forest, Rumpel puts Belle in the dungeon. Okay. And then she laughs when he makes a joke about skinning children, so it's like...
It's meant to be.
Belle chips a cup. Chip. But he says, it's just a cup.
That one was not as good.
I know. Belle literally just wants light. She's trying to open the curtains, but Rumple has the curtains nailed down. But then, like, she falls while she's trying to tear him down, and he catches her. Belle's perceptive about his loneliness. He tells her that he had a son, and he lost him and his mother. She tells him he's not a monster. And we learn Belle wants to be a hero, and so she saw this going with Rumple as the chance to be brave for her kingdom. And so then Rumple lets her go.
Back in Storybrooke, Mary Margaret, Ruby, and Ashley, Cinderella, go out for a Galentine's night. It's Valentine's Day, and David is buying 2 cards.
Ugh.
And then Gold's buying duct tape and rope.
Gold. You know how guys be.
Why did you interrupt me to say that?
It's just funny, like, he's cheating on his wife.
I understand why it's funny.
He's gonna, like, trying to murder a man.
Mr. Gold kidnaps Mr. French in his own truck. Buddy. And that's that.
Belle, while she is leaving, because Rumple let her go, she runs into Regina. Regina encourages Belle to kiss Rumpelstiltskin to break the curse of the evil taken root in him, because true love's kiss can break any curse. So Belle comes back, and Rumple is just, like, so fucking thrilled. So they kiss. His skin starts turning normal, suggesting that, like, the curse is being broken, but he starts freaking out.
It wasn't love.
He starts saying that no one could ever love him, even though it's literally true love's kiss. So he locks her back up in the dungeon.
Meanwhile, in Storybrooke, Gold chokes and beats Mr. French, yelling about Belle, which is like, what? Like, and then he says, you shut her out. You had her love and you shut her out. She's gone. She's gone forever. She's not coming back, and it's your fault. He's talking to himself.
So then Rumpelstiltskin, he's like going in a rage. He smashes every single teacup except the chipped one. So then he lets Belle go. Belle pops off at him and calls him a coward.
Can you do an Australian accent?
No.
Oh, shoot. I feel like we should have prefaced this by saying the actress for Belle is the most Australian person ever.
Wait, should we just, like, say who has accents? Because I feel like you need the full picture.
What? Who else has accents?
Gold.
Well, yeah, Gold.
Scottish. Graham is Irish, I think.
Yes.
Geppetto, Marco's Italian.
So, Belle is all like, no, it doesn't.
Okay, wait.
I can't do that. That's it.
Yes. You have to do it.
Okay, I mean, it's gonna be bad.
So Rumple's all like,
my power means more to me than you.
No, it doesn't. You just don't think I can love you.
Not to that time.
And then she's like, all you'll have is an empty heart and a chipped cup. These are, like, sad moments in the episode, but she's like, all you'll have is an empty heart and a chipped cup.
Chipped cup.
And a chipped cup. She's like, and a chipped cup.
Because she's British.
After this, Regina, like, shows up at Rumpelstiltskin's place, and she says that Belle was exiled by her father upon her return, and she killed herself.
Oh my god, I totally forgot about this. That is absolutely insane. I forgot about that, like, plot line. That
she told she told Rumple that she killed herself. It's a lie, by the way. He puts the chipped cup on a pedestal, and it's like a rare moment of vulnerability.
Back in Storybrooke, at Galentine's night, Sean is Cinderella's prince, by the way. Sean surprises Ashley at the bar and proposes. And then David gives Mary Margaret the wrong Valentine's card. It says Catherine's name on it. Okay. Dude! Emma arrests Mr. Gold for battery. It turns out that Regina put Mr. French up to the robbery to steal the chipped cup. Regina asks Mr. Gold what his name is if he wants it back. He says Rumpelstiltskin. Like, we always had the vibe that Mr. Gold remembered the pre-curse stuff, but now we know he does. By the way, remember, Regina lied about Belle killing herself in the Enchanted Forest. Regina has Belle locked up in a mental asylum under the hospital.
Ma'am.
Episode 13.
What happened to Frederick?
Remember Frederick?
Remember him?
Episode starts. Charming is on the run from King George in order to find Snow. And then he's kidnapped by Abigail, who doesn't want to marry him either, and she wants to help him escape. We find out Abigail was originally going to marry Frederick, but he died protecting Midas and was turned to gold.
It wasn't love.
So then Abigail says that Lake Nostos has waters that can return to you something you once lost, but it's guarded by a beast. So Charming volunteers to fight the beast and get the water for Abigail to heal Frederick. Oh, and they're standing at like Frederick's gold statue in a little like temple thing.
In Storybrooke, so we learn Catherine applied to law school in Boston and got in. And so she's like gonna go. David goes and talks to Mary Margaret about it, and she wants to tell Catherine the truth, and David says that he chooses Mary Margaret. It's like, sir, why couldn't you have decided that two months ago?
Literally, most problems would have been avoided.
Now we finally learn the new guy's name. His name is August Wayne Booth. That's him over there. Wait, no. What's...
John Wilkes Booth.
David tells Catherine that he wants to leave her, but he doesn't tell her about Mary Margaret. Buddy, come on. They had, like, discussed and, like, had agreed that that's what they were gonna do, and then he just, like, doesn't do it. And so then we see August adding new pages to the book. Regina tells Catherine about the affair between David and Mary Margaret, and it's like, why didn't you tell her sooner? Bad friend alert.
It's almost like she didn't care about being a friend, but just about getting revenge on Mary Margaret.
David then lies to Mary Margaret about telling Catherine. So he's now lied to both Catherine and Mary Margaret.
He's a dick.
And so then Catherine confronts Mary Margaret at school and slaps her in front of everyone. Instantly, everyone in town starts shunning her, Mary Margaret. Someone painted tramp on the side of her car. And then there's like seemingly no repercussions for David. Who's surprised?
No one. Turns out that the beast that is guarding Lake Nostos is a siren, and the siren tries to seduce Charming, but he manages to kill her and bring Abigail the water. And then when they like give it to, they pour it on Frederick, it all, the gold all like melts off. So then like Abigail and Frederick are back together, happily ever after. Charming goes back on his quest for Snow.
Yeah, so that all happens kind of in between Snow telling Charming that she doesn't love him and Snow taking the potion. Mary Margaret ends it with David because of his lying both to Catherine and to her. Emma finds the book again in the gutter, so yay, she and Henry are happy. Catherine leaves to find love and a new life in Boston. She leaves a letter for David and Mary Margaret telling them to be together, but Regina uses one of her skull keys that Emma had found to get into their house, and she like steals the letter before David can find it. And then Regina also has red spray paint in her desk, so she's the one who graffitied Mary Margaret's car, because of course she did. And then Catherine gets into an accident as she's trying to leave Storybrooke, of course.
Episode 14.
Dreamy. We meet Nova, who is a kind of fairy in training. She's being instructed by the Blue Fairy. She's clumsy. She's a mess. Blue clearly thinks she's incapable and untrustworthy, which, you know, fair. Nova accidentally drops some fairy dust, which falls on a dwarf egg. Dwarves come from eggs.
And that's that.
That's just how it is. And so then who we know as Grumpy comes out of his egg, like, all smiley. Like, the dust landed on his egg.
So Mary Margaret tries to get volunteers to sell the nuns candles for Miner's Day, but she's now the town pariah, so literally no one will help. But then Leroy, or Grumpy, meets Storybrooke Nova, who is Astrid, Sister Astrid, because all the
fairies
are nuns. Oh, did we even mention that? All the fairies are nuns?
Yeah.
So Mother Superior is the Blue Fairy. But yeah, so Leroy meets Astrid. He's only nice to her. Emma finds Catherine's abandoned car, and then Sydney shows up at the scene.
Dwarves don't fall in love, they don't get married, they don't have children, which is why they come from eggs. They only work. You know, I feel like the dwarves are kind of a metaphor for the working class.
Anyway. You have to say under capitalism.
Under capitalism.
They're obviously the working class. Okay, anyways.
Okay, no, they're from the working class.
Okay, that's all getting cut out.
When a dwarf picks up their like, axe for the first time, it gives them their dwarf name. So Grumpy picks up his axe and it says Dreamy. So his name is originally Dreamy.
Leroy volunteers to sell candles to be close to Astrid. So Sister Astrid is kind of causing the financial ruin of the nuns, but they need to sell a lot of candles to make the rent. So Leroy promises to sell all of them. And of course, who are they paying the rent to? It's Rumpelstiltskin. It's Mr. Gold. Regina gets Catherine's phone records for Sydney to give to Emma to find where Catherine is. And Sydney's trying to point Emma towards blaming David and or Mary Margaret for Catherine's disappearance.
In the Enchanted Forest, Dreamy, Grumpy, and Nova meet, they bond. Belle meets Dreamy in a tavern and gives him some pretty solid advice on love, and this kind of takes place sometime after Rumpel let her go the second time.
So after the whole, like, after true love the kiss and everything like that.
Dreamy and Nova decide to run off and sail the world together. They kiss.
It wasn't love. It wasn't.
They are in love. Leroy and Mary Margaret are hard at work trying to get those candles sold, but also they aren't exactly, like, popular people in this town.
They're like the two most hated people in town. Yeah.
So they don't sell any candles. And Leroy needs to tell Astrid this. But then he gets a little scared to tell her. And then he tells her that they sold out. So he's getting himself in a problem. What? He's getting himself into a
sticky situation.
What did you say? So then phone records say that David called Catherine before she crashed, when he says he didn't. So suspicious things are happening.
So Nova and Dreamy are planning on going away. The dwarves are supportive of Dreamy, following his love, but the boss dwarf named Bossy and the Blue Fairy discourage him. Blue is like, you need to let Nova become the great fairy that she can be.
I don't think she cares about.
Right, yeah. And then Bossy and the Blue Fairy only see Nova and Grumpy as, like, worth what they can provide for the world instead of, like, you know, having their own lives and relationships.
Yep.
So Dreamy breaks it off with Nova and he gets a new axe that now says Grumpy.
Thanks, capitalism.
So they, like, crushed his spirit, basically. Yeah.
Back in Storybrooke, Leroy has a solution. He axes the electrical lines, which cause power outage, so people are forced to buy candles to see the festival at night. And, like, when they're up there, at first Mary Margaret thinks he's just, like, gonna jump off the roof. And then he says, I'm not gonna jump. Are you crazy? I could hit somebody. You know how much damage I could do? I'm solidly built. And then Granny lights Mary Margaret's candle, showing how the town is beginning to forgive her. Because early in the episode, Granny was being rude to Mary Margaret about, you know,
she's
the
like,
whole,
you should be ashamed of yourself.
Yeah, you should be ashamed of yourself. And then Emma has to take David to the station to talk. I like how there's casually a murder investigation, or like a dissident.
Yeah, there's like this whole, like, the main plot.
It's like a sweet little plot.
The festival about Miner's Day and the candles. And then the subplot is like, David's being investigated for potentially kidnapping and murdering his wife.
Episode 15.
Red-handed. This is the Red and Granny backstory episode. So in their village, there's this huge wolf plaguing them. And Granny says that red repels wolves, like the color, which is why Red is always wearing her red hood. Little Red Riding Hood. Red has a secret romance with her childhood best friend, Peter. Peter and the wolf.
Don't say that.
There's a hunting party going out in search of the wolf. Granny sits in front of the door all night with a crossbow. Because she's just that kind of gal. This is when Red meets Snow. She finds Snow in their hen house stealing eggs. They go to get water, but the water is red, and the entire hunting party is dead around the well.
Back in Storybrooke, Granny is overworking Ruby and cramps her style. So Ruby quits and plans to leave town. She's like waiting at the bus stop. And then Dr. Whale is, of course, being a creep who's surprised. And then Emma and Mary Margaret see Ruby at the bus stop, and then they take her in for the moment. So there's a little gals trio in the loft. Mm-hmm. I forgot to mention that her apartment is a loft.
It's a key detail. Granny makes some reference to the Second Ogre's War, so it's like there's multiple, I don't know. Granny's trying to dissuade anyone else from hunting the wolf, but then Red decides that she's gonna hunt the wolf, so that she can be with Peter instead of hiding from Granny. So she and Snow go out looking. They find huge wolf prints that, as they go on, they turn into human prints. Werewolf. The prints lead up to Red's window, so they think that Peter is the wolf.
Yeah.
Peter the wolf.
Okay. Mary Margaret goes looking for Catherine in the woods, and then she sees David, who's in some kind of trance. It's weird. Emma realizes that Ruby is good at answering the phone, so she gives her a job as, like, the secretary at the police department. Ruby and Emma go looking for David in the woods, but he's lying unconscious and doesn't remember the past 24 hours. Looks very suspicious about possibly, like, blacking out and possibly killing Catherine, so he is suspicious. How many times should I say that?
Suspicious.
She's suspicious. Emma is, like, on the phone with Ruby, and she's telling Ruby to, like, go search at the toll bridge, which is where David went when he was dreamwalking after his coma. And then Ruby finds something in the ground, digs it up, and it's a box with a human heart in it. And it's, like, pretty traumatic for Ruby. Like, Ruby's not chill with, like, doing that.
Then Red chains Peter up to stop him from hurting anyone else as a wolf and, like, stays with him through the night. But, uh-oh, Red is actually the wolf. So, goodbye, Peter.
Peter's dead.
Yeah.
It's heartbreaking. It's, like, a heartbreaking moment because she, like, stays with him through the night because she wants to be there for him. And Red realizes what she's done and that she just, like, absolutely, like, brutally killed her. Love.
Turns out that Granny and also Red's mom and grandfather were werewolves, and the red cloak that Red wears is enchanted to keep her from turning into a wolf, but she doesn't wear it a lot of the time, so
that's why
she keeps turning into the wolf.
Back in Storybrooke, Ruby goes back to Granny's and is like, I'm not cut out for the police work. Will you take me back? And then Granny's like, of course I will. I was just making sure you were working hard because I wanted you to take over the business when I retire. Then Mary Margaret is kind of like comforting David and being like, hey, like, don't jump to conclusions. Everything's fine. And then Emma comes and it's like, so there actually turned out to be fingerprints in the box. They're like, oh my God, it must be David's. And then she's like, it was actually you, Mary Margaret. So,
ruh-roh.
Episode 16.
Heart of Darkness.
Snow White is living with the dwarves, but she's, like, angry and mean and wants vengeance all the time. They have, like, an intervention that's mediated by, of course, Jiminy Cricket. And then Snow decides that she's like, I'm gonna kill Regina. So the intervention did not work.
In fact, it worsened it.
It really did. Grumpy wants to help Snow by bringing her back to Rumple to undo potion. He gives Snow a magic bow that always finds its target, so he's not really helping Grumpy. He's like, yeah, you should kill her. Love is the only magic that Rumple hasn't been able to bottle.
So Emma kind of has to arrest Mary Margaret because her fingerprints were found inside a box with a human heart in it. And then it turns out that the box that the heart was in is Mary Margaret's jewelry box, so things are not looking good for her. And then also Emma finds a huge knife in Mary Margaret's, like, vent in her room. It's not looking good. Henry learns that August believes in the book as well. David goes to Archie.
Are you pointing? Sorry, I blacked out.
Just like David. David goes to Archie to help remember his blackouts that he's, I guess, been having. Archie hypnotizes David, and he has, like, this recovered memory of watching Snow trying to kill Regina and hearing, "You can't kill her." Really? Watch me. So obviously it's not like a storybook memory, but how would he know that? So he thinks that Mary Margaret, like, killed Catherine, potentially. Meanwhile, Henry steals Regina's skull keys, and one of them unlocks Mary Margaret's apartment.
So he knows. Charming learns that Snow White wants to kill the Queen, so he also goes to Rumple, and Rumple tells Charming where Snow is in exchange for his cloak. And then Charming's like, okay, sure. And then we get, of course, I will always find you. It's getting kind of annoying. It wasn't love. Charming kisses Snow to try to undo the potion, but she doesn't love him, so it doesn't really work right now. Snow shoots at Regina with the bow, but Charming takes the arrow. And then they kiss, and then she remembers. I don't really know, why does she remember that time and not the time before?
Well, because she's like, you would die for me? No one oh, has ever been willing to die for.
Let me say that now. Because, like, she kind of falls in love with him because he would die for her. And, wow, I did much better than you, I guess. That was sarcasm. So then she remembers, and it's like, yay, they can be together, but then they're instantly found by King George's soldiers. But then we still get, as they're being pulled away by the soldiers, they still say, I will always find you, in a British accent.
Mm-hmm. It wasn't love.
Snow then apologizes to the dwarves about, you know, how, like, bitchy she was. Then they all set off to go save Charming. Yay, yay.
David then goes to see Mary Margaret in jail and asks, like, if she killed Catherine. And Mary Margaret's like, when everyone thought it was you, I stood by you. Get the fuck out. Then Mary Margaret is making her jail bed.
She, like, setting it all up.
And she finds a skull key that unlocks her cell. So someone put that in there. Then the heart is confirmed to be Catherine's. So, dead alert.
Okay.
It wasn't love.
Emma suspects Regina framing Mary Margaret. And then she goes to Gold for help taking Regina down. And then Mary Margaret escapes from jail with the key.
The episode ends with Rumple taking the hair from Charming's cloak with the hair from Snow. And it makes true love in a test tube. So he bottled true love for his collection.
His little collection.
Episode 17.
Hat trick.
Mary Margaret is running through the woods. She escaped her cell. Emma's searching for her because her arraignment is the next morning. And she needs to be there. Because if they find out that she escaped, she's done. It's not good. Emma almost runs over Jefferson, who is played by Sebastian Stan. She gives him a ride home. And then it turns out that Jefferson has this huge fucking house in the middle of the forest, and he gives Emma tea, but then it drugs her, and he's actually been spying on her. So then Emma goes and tries to hide in a room when she's not drugged anymore, and then it turns out that Mary Margaret is tied up in there. Turns out he knows about the curse and thinks that Emma has magic, and he wants her to get the hat to work.
She's like, what are you talking about?
Yeah, and he sounds insane, but everything he's saying is actually true.
In the Enchanted Forest, Jefferson is still named Jefferson, and he has a daughter named Grace, and he can do some kind of magic, and used to do jobs for Regina, but he doesn't anymore. But Regina wants him to do one more job for her, and in exchange, she'll, like, give them a bunch of money so that he can give Grace the life that she deserves, because they're, like, poor. So it turns out his magic is he has this magic hat that if he spins it, it, like, opens a portal. So they jump into it, and it's basically a way to go between realms. And the hat has a rule. The hat is sentient. The hat has a rule that the same number of people that go into it have to come out of it. It's two of them. They go to Wonderland. The Regina, and the Queen of Hearts have some kind of history, some kind of beef. Regina gets a box from, like, a wall of the boxes, like the ones where she keeps her hearts. She puts some Wonderland food in it, and then Henry I appears. So the Queen of Hearts, like, stole her father from her somehow. But then Regina leaves Wonderland with Henry I, and so Jefferson gets left behind and isn't able to go home to Grace. The Queen of Hearts then cuts Jefferson's head off, but he lives somehow. And so he spends the rest of his time in Wonderland basically destined to make another magic hat so that he can return to Grace. And it drives him insane because he can't get any of the hats to work. And he makes literally thousands of hats.
So he's the Mad Hatter.
And it's really heartbreaking. Wants to get back to Grace.
It's really heartbreaking. He just goes insane trying to get back to his daughter. In Storybook, Grace is with another family. And they named her Paige. And Jefferson is always, like, watching her and everything because he was cursed to remember their life together back in the Enchanted Forest. He has the life that he wanted to give her with this big house, but he's not able to give it to her, and they're forced to be apart. So he has to just, like, watch that happen. Mm-hmm. And it's truly, like, the worst possible curse ever. Like, it's the most evil thing ever. I think it's worse than anybody else's, like, curses. And it turns out that he has a cut around his neck where his head was cut off. So it's like, proof. So then Emma and Mary Margaret escape Jefferson's mansion. Mary Margaret goes back to the cell in time for her arraignment hearing, and Gold and Regina, it turns out, put the skull key there.
Sneaky.
Episode 18.
Stable Boy. So we learned that Regina and Gold, in the past, like a week ago, made a deal where Regina would get the DA to drop Gold's battery charges. You remember when he beat up Mr. French? And then Gold tells Regina to make something bad happen to Catherine and frame Mary Margaret. The DA is King George, and he's just like absolute shit at his job. And the system is corrupt. August and Emma go back to the scene of the crime at the toll bridge where the heart was found. They find a piece of a shovel. So they're like, whoever has the rest of the shovel must have killed Catherine. So they sneak into Regina's house and they find the matching shovel. And August gets like a bad leg cramp. Keep that in your mind. Emma comes back with a search warrant and like goes straight for where the shovel was, but it's gone. So then Emma thinks that August tipped Regina off.
So this is back in the Enchanted Forest. It's before, like, pretty much everything. It's like when Regina's a teenager and she does like equestrian stuff, and then her dad is like super supportive, and when she's like super happy, just like riding horses. But her mom is not. We meet her mom,
Cora.
Cora's the worst person ever.
Let's rearrange. It wasn't love.
But Cora is just like super awful and critical and emotionally abusive. Because of that, Regina hates magic because Cora has magic.
She like uses it to keep Regina in line.
Yeah, it's bad. But then Regina has a secret romance with Stable Boy Daniel. Daniel wants Regina to tell Cora about them, but obviously it's not very easy to do. Regina saves Snow White when she's really young. She's like, what, like 12-ish,
yeah,
on a runaway horse. And then Regina's just like super nice and like comforting and reassuring to Snow. And because, and like,
genuinely.
Yeah, genuinely.
Not in like a fake way, yes, that she starts to do.
Yes.
Like, she's just a good
Regina
person.
Is a very good person at this point. So the king, because Regina saved Snow, proposes to Regina. And Cora accepted it for her. Regina's not happy, so she goes and proposes to Daniel and wants to run away. So they're now engaged. When they're doing that, when she, like, proposes and they agree to run away, they leave the barn doors wide open. So Snow catches them. And Snow's like, you don't want to marry my dad? Regina tells Snow about true love, and it's really sweet, and Regina's like, your dad is nice, but like, I'm in love with Daniel, and he's my true love and everything. Snow promises to keep it a secret, especially from Cora. But then Cora guilts and manipulates Snow, like little child Snow, into telling her about Regina and Daniel.
Because Snow's mother is dead, obviously. Mm-hmm. And so Cora basically just uses that to be like, I don't want Regina to lose her mother. And Snow's like, no, I don't want that either.
It's so bad. Regina and Daniel are like just about to run away, and then Cora stops them and rips out Daniel's heart and kills him. Jesus Christ.
It wasn't love.
And this is all like right in front of Regina. It's as they're running away, and Cora just does this. And she says, this is your happy ending to Regina. Bitch, no it's not. But then Regina finds out that Snow is the one that told Cora, and there's just like ever so slight switch in her expression and tone while they're talking.
It's like you can see the moment,
mm-hmm,
that Regina turns, I mean, I don't want to say like turns evil, but like,
yeah, it was gradual.
Her life like pinpoints, focuses on vengeance.
Yeah. On how Snow ruined her life, or like this whole situation.
And then in Storybrooke, Sydney had brought like flowers for Emma's office. Then it turns out there was a bug in the flowers, which is how Regina has been like knowing all of Emma's moves. Emma now knows that Sydney was a spy. And then Ruby, always Ruby, poor Ruby, finds Catherine in the alley behind Granny, so she isn't dead.
Let me do that better.
She's alive.
Episode 19.
The Return.
I hate this.
It's a doozy.
August is looking for something that Gold has in his shop, and Gold is suspicious of August because he like catches him. Then Gold says that he's only ever broken one deal in his life. Oh, Catherine, back to life. She actually was locked in a basement and drugged. And it turns out that Gold abducted her, and Regina had wanted her to be killed.
That was like they're conspiring.
It was so weird. And also it raises the question of like, whose fucking heart was that? That's the,
oh my God, yeah.
Mary Margaret's class gives her a card that says, "We're so glad you didn't kill Mrs. Nolan." So,
love them for that. Enchanted Forest. Bay is very skeptical of magic. He doesn't want Rumple using it. And so Rumple promises him, they make a deal that if Bay can find a way to get rid of his power without killing him, that he'll do it. We learn that Rumple created a truce in the Ogre's War. Probably the only good thing he did while being the Dark One. Then Bay's friend tells him about the Rule Gorm, who's actually the Blue Fairy. And so the Blue Fairy then gives Bay a way to...
What?
What?
Gives Bay a way?
The Blue Fairy gives Bay a way to get them to a world without magic, with the last magic bean in their realm.
So magic beans create portals, and this is just the last one of them.
Mm-hmm. The Blue Fairy says that the only thing keeping part of Rumple human is Bay. They go to use the bean. The bean turns into a portal. Bay is going through, but Rumple backs out at the last minute because he's scared. He's scared of being without his power. Bay is like screaming at him like, "You promised." And then Bay goes through the portal. It closes. And then Rumple like immediately regrets it and is like digging at the ground, like crying, like saying, "Bay, I want to come with you," over and over.
It's so heartbreaking.
It's like,
this is I think the worst scene for me. That moment where he like was too consumed with fear and was being that coward
and ultimately lost his
and
son
and it's
over
just
it.
That one moment, but then he lost his son over it, and the moment after it where he's realizing and he's just trying to make up for it, but he can't. And he's like, "No, Bay, I want to come with you." And then he's just like crying, and it's so fucking awful. Mr. Gold sneaks into August's room at Granny's and then finds a picture of the dagger, the Dark One's dagger.
So it's like, how do you know about that?
August mentions to somebody that his dad is in Storybrooke, but he hasn't told his dad that he's there. Meanwhile, David keeps trying to apologize to Mary Margaret for implying that she did kill Catherine. But he's not doing it well. Back to the Gold plotline. Gold goes to Archie, to the therapist, thinking that August is his son, and he's literally just trying to be like, "What should I do to make up for what I've done?" But then he thinks that August might be there to kill him. He says to August, "I know who you are." And then August says, "Papa," which is what Bay called him. So then Gold, this emotional moment, he's asking August to forgive him, and he's crying, and August hugs him, and he shows August where the knife is and tells him to destroy it.
Which is a huge deal for him.
Yeah, like, you would, oh my God.
He's obsessed with his back power, and he's so scared of being without it, and so the fact that he's, like, telling who he thinks is his son to destroy it is, like,
such a big improvement. But then August uses it and tries to control him, and then Gold realizes that he isn't Bay. But then Gold is like, "That knife has no power here." So now August just kind of revealed himself. So Gold realizes that August is from the Enchanted Forest, is from, you know, World with Magic. And August tells him that he's sick and gonna die. And also that Emma trusts him and he wants her to believe. Gold ends up letting him go.
Because he also wants Emma to believe.
Yes. Meanwhile, Regina forces Sydney to confess. Sydney Glass to confess for the Catherine stuff. You know, for kidnapping,
drugging,
that whole thing, putting her heart in a box. And then Emma, at the end of the episode, Emma says that she's gonna take back Henry. So,
yeah.
That's something.
She's like, "You tried to take away someone I love, now I'm gonna take away someone you love." Rumple talks to the Blue Fairy and is like, "How do I get back to my son?" And the only way for him to follow Bay into the other world is with a curse. And so he then dedicates his whole life to finding a way to do that, literally to like follow his son. So literally all of it, the entire curse, and like the way that he was so involved in like Snow White and Charming's life and Regina, he's like orchestrating the entire curse literally so that he can get back to his son.
And so the curse is supposed to be, there's, you know, it's it's a land without magic and everything, but that's like his happy ending. So like his goal was just to get there. Episode 20.
The Stranger. Emma's planning a custody battle with Regina. Henry's like, someone added a story to the book. Obviously it was August, like we know that it's August.
He was adding it.
Yeah. Also, just a side note, like, I feel like everyone brushes over the fact that the mayor has keys to everyone's house, like, way too quickly. Like, Emma literally knows that she has keys to everyone's house.
Okay, let's move on.
It's weird.
So the story in the book is about Pinocchio. So Pinocchio starts on the boat with Geppetto, and there's only one flotation device, so Pinocchio sacrifices himself so Geppetto can live, and Geppetto wishes to save him, and the blue fairy shows up and turns him into a real boy, and he will remain a real boy if he remains brave, truthful, and unselfish. That's the deal.
Then we flash to August turning to wood, so therefore August is Pinocchio. Pinocchio.
So that means that the dad that he didn't tell that he was in town is Geppetto. So we'll get into that.
Regina orchestrates this little plan to get David to have dinner with her, which is weird.
It's really weird.
Weird. Yeah, and then she tries to kiss him, and he's like, oh, no. Yeah, and then she just, like, smashes him here. August takes Emma out of Storybrooke to tell her his story.
So that's
coming up.
They're the
only two people that can leave.
We cut forward in time in the Enchanted Forest to when the Blue Fairy is asking Geppetto to make the magical wardrobe that sent Emma to the world. And it turns out that actually two people can go through. But then Geppetto thinks that Pinocchio will turn back to wood in the curse. So he will only make the wardrobe if Pinocchio can go through.
It wasn't love.
So then Geppetto sends Pinocchio through. This is when plans have changed and Snow gave birth to Emma. And so he tells Pinocchio to look out for Emma. Blue tells Geppetto to tell Snow that plans have changed, but he doesn't.
He still sends Pinocchio through.
He still sends Pinocchio through. But that's the part where he's like a little deceitful. A little deceitful, babes.
The story of August's life.
Story of my life.
No.
So August tells Emma that he was the 7-year-old boy who found her on the side of the road. She had always known that a kid had, like, found her on the side of the road and brought her in. And so August's like, I was that kid. Since he wasn't there for Emma when she decided to stay in Storybrooke, he starts to turn to wood because he, like, failed on his mission.
So he's not brave, truthful, and unselfish. He was selfish.
The opposite, really. And so he tries to show Emma that he's turning into wood, that his leg is turning into wood, but because she doesn't believe, she can't see it. And she's like consciously choosing not to believe. Well, maybe not consciously, but she's like kind of choosing not to believe.
Yeah.
And so Emma and August kind of have this fight where he's like, why do you refuse to believe after all, like, this proof that we've shown you? And I was like, I didn't choose that. Like, how is that fair? I can't be responsible for everyone's happiness. Which, like, yeah.
I get it. So when they come to the land without magic, Pinocchio, he's also a child, and they're both in the foster care system, but he does, like, kind of choose to leave Emma.
Yeah, so probably, like, a month after they got there.
Yeah, so, like, Emma's still a baby, and he's kind of, like, you know, I think he's a kid trying to deal with responsibility of this, like, savior, right?
So then August finally goes to see Marco, his father, Geppetto, and asks if he wants an assistant free of charge. And so they're, like, spending time together.
Yeah, and they were, like, bonding over really woodworking stuff.
Yeah. And then Emma kind of, I mean, technically, like, abducts Henry.
Yeah.
But she kind of just, like, takes Henry and is like, we're leaving Storybrooke. She's like, do you want to leave? Do you want to live with me? He's like, yeah. They just kind of go.
Yeah, and Henry's kind of like, oh. Episode 21.
An apple as red as blood.
The penultimate episode. Present day, Regina has this nightmare that Henry ties her up and everyone is hunting her, and then Emma kills her. Henry stops Emma from leaving because he's like, this isn't the solution to our problem, so.
He's so mature.
Rumple designed the curse that if Emma is killed, the curse is broken.
So that's why, like, this whole time Regina hasn't just killed Emma.
Gold is planning a trip, anticipating that the curse is about to get broken. So,
yeah.
Things are heating up. Mary Margaret calls out Emma for leaving without saying goodbye and abducting Henry. Emma says, I want what's best for him. And then Mary Margaret says, and running is what's best for him, or is that what's best for you?
So King George literally puts Charming in a guillotine, but Regina, like, saves his life. So kind of her. She, like, kind of takes him in order to take down Snow. Snow and the gang attack on the castle to get Charming back. And the gang includes the dwarves, Red and Granny, and, like, all of the fairies.
Yeah, like, a lot of fairies.
Like, 1,000 fairies.
Regina left a note for Jefferson on Grace's bike because she knew that he would be watching. She has enough magic to use the hat again in exchange for a new story for Jefferson and Grace.
He doesn't want Grace to remember. He wants to forget.
Henry goes to August about Emma leaving, and he sees him turning into wood because he believes in the curse. August wants to spend the little time he has left with his father. So basically he's like, Operation Cobra is up to you now.
Snow gets to Charming's cell, but Regina had put Charming in a mirror or something and, like, took him back to her palace. Regina tells Snow to meet her where it all began, which is where Regina saved her from the horse. Regina shows Snow Daniel's grave. Snow, this whole time, didn't know that Daniel had died, and especially didn't know that Cora had killed him. So she's like, you know, sorry. Regina presents this, like, poison apple. Snow eats it so that Charming will live, otherwise Regina will kill him. And we see that when Snow eats it and, like, is being put under this curse, that Charming is, like, physically in pain because they're true loves. Apple rolls out of her hand, where it's snatched through the portal opened by the hat by Jefferson. So now Regina has the apple. There's a little cooking montage. She makes a little apple turnover.
Very cute.
Little baking queen. Then Emma comes to Regina and is basically like, I will leave town. This is hurting Henry, but I still want to be in his life.
So that's her condition.
That's her condition for leaving town. And then Regina gives her this apple turnover. It's like a treat for the road. Emma breaks the news to Henry that she's leaving. Henry's like, you're the only one who can stop her being Regina. And Emma's like, stop her from what? All she's ever done is fight for you.
Oh, yeah, it's like this really sweet moment where she's like kind of realizing like this insecure kind of like competition between the birth mother and the adopted mother is just hurting Henry.
Yeah, and so then Henry sees the apple turnover and is trying to stop Emma from eating it because he knows about the poison apple. Right before he takes a bite of it, he goes, you may not believe in the curse or in me, but I believe in you. So he takes a bite of it and, you know, collapses to the floor.
Episode over.
Yeah.
Episode 22.
A land without magic.
We start Henry in the hospital. Dr. Whale is working to try to get him alive. Emma and Regina are crying. It's a mess. It's a mess, people.
It's a goddamn mess.
Emma starts to believe. She's starting to believe. She picks up the book and has like these little flashbacks to all the few moments she has spent in the Enchanted Forest when she was born. And Emma looks like so hopeful when she remembers because she's kind of putting the pieces together that if the curse exists, there's...
Like she has her parents.
And then Regina understands what's happening and it's not right. It's not right.
It's not good.
David is planning on leaving town.
Charming's imprisoned by Regina.
Ew. Who rescues him? Who's the one that saves Charming while he's escaping? Wait, let me point.
It's Graham.
It's the huntsman. It's him.
It's, yeah, the huntsman.
Oh my god.
Then Regina, like, sends Charming to the Infinite Forest.
The one where Hansel and Gretel
and the dad were. It's infinite. So Rumple, like, magics himself in. And it's like, I can help you find Snow. So in exchange for helping Charming find Snow, Rumple wants Charming to get his little bottle of, like, the true love potion in a safe place, aka Maleficent. Charming goes to Maleficent's, like, fortress. She's a dragon. he like takes this egg that the potion is in, is kind of like slams it into her like neck.
It's weird. So while Emma and Regina are kind of working together because they want to save Henry, obviously, they go to Rumpelstiltskin and we learn that he put a drop of the true love potion on the parchment of the dark curse, which is why Emma can break it, because she's the product of true love. Mr. Gold, Rumpelstiltskin, also gives Emma her father's sword to retrieve the potion.
Because they're like, this potion can save Henry.
Meanwhile, we go to August's room, and he's like, he turns completely into wood. It was really sad. It was a sad moment. Mm-hmm. Because Emma basically goes to him and is like, I know what's going on now. But then August turns to wood. It's too late. But it's like so sad because he was supposed to be her guide. Mm-hmm. And when she needed a guide because she remembered, she went to him, but it was too late. As a part of the curse, Maleficent has been trapped in dragon form underneath the library. And the library has always been like locked up and everything. So then Emma goes to fight and get the potion from inside Maleficent. It's this thing where like the elevator, you get down, it needs two people, so she has to trust Regina at the top to like safely do all that. I'm just gonna do it from memory. Okay, so Emma ends up retrieving it, and when she needs to come back up, Regina's not there. She's not responding. So then she's like, what's going on? And then Mr. Gold is like, the elevator's stuck, Regina left, so why don't you just toss the potion to me up here? Bad decision. She does it, and she starts climbing up, and then when she gets up, Regina is all tied up, and then Gold basically took their only solution to saving Henry. So that's something.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, in the hospital, Mary Margaret is reading a story to Henry from a book, but then Henry starts coding.
Uh-oh.
So Regina had that deal with Jefferson, remember? She grabbed the apple.
Do you recall?
She grabbed the apple, and she's supposed to make Jefferson forget so that he wouldn't be cursed to remember his life with Grace. But Regina backed out of that deal because the poison apple didn't work, and obviously it's killing her son. Jefferson goes down to the mental asylum, and it turns out that Regina put Sydney down there.
Just casually.
But that's like brushed by. Like, it's just like you see him in the other room. And it's like, what the fuck is going on? Jefferson goes and grabs Belle. And he tells her to tell Gold that Regina locked her down there. So Jefferson knows exactly how to, you know, get Regina in trouble.
Charming is about to go, like, save Snow. Rumpel gives him, like, a nice little outfit.
You gotta move when you say Rumpelstiltskin. God. You're, like, literally like this Rumpelstiltskin. I'm, like, trying to point to him.
Rumpelstiltskin gives Charming a nice little outfit, so he's ready for his big moment. Charming wakes Snow up, it's true love's kiss.
We know how it goes.
They get engaged.
So then Belle comes in to the pawn shop and tells Gold about Regina fucking, like, locking her up. But, like, Belle doesn't remember anything. But then also Gold thought she was dead, so it's like this... Oh. So then we go to the hospital, and Henry dies. And there's this really sad cello music playing.
So sad.
And Emma's like smoothing out his hair as she like goes to like hug him and say goodbye and everything. But please, stop swimming. And then Emma goes and kisses his forehead. But guess what? That breaks the curse, because that's true love, baby. That's true love, baby.
Yeah.
Emma breaks the curse. But then Regina, like knowing what's happening, runs and hides. But actually, it's a flat, and then she goes home, and then she, like, cries in Henry's bed, and it's, like, so sad. It's so sad because,
yeah.
So, like, she also, her son was dying. So then, this is really my episode.
Yeah.
There's an I Will Always That's Find You, because, like, Mary Margaret and David are, like, walking on the sidewalk, and they're both, like, not happy with each other because David screwed Mary Margaret over and everything, but...
Then the curse is broken, so they remember,
and they
like, run to each other in the street.
And, of course, it's an I Will Always Love You.
It was...
Belle now remembers, now that the curse is broken, and tells Rumpel that she loves him, and he says it back, but then he's like, I have to do something at the well first, and it's, like, weird. So then he takes the true love potion that he took from Emma and he dumps it into the well, and it restored magic. Because magic is power. That's what Rumpel says.
This is very typical Rumpel behavior.
And then Belle's just kinda like watching it happen, just kinda like, uh-oh, but then she's like also happy. The curse is broken, but nobody went back to the Enchanted Forest. That's the thing. Everybody's like, Where are we now? So then this finale is really just like a cliffhanger. Like, the curse is broken, but then, like, there's so many other questions. That's the finale.
Yeah.
On to season two.
What's coming next?
What do they do after the curse is broken?
Why did they go back?
Who's this?
Who's here?
We're gonna learn that very quickly.
Yeah.
Final kind of stuff in the season. Season one has 10 I Will Always Find Yous between Charming and Snow White. Mm-hmm. That's going to multiply.
Okay,
Let's review the dead.
Henry I, Daniel, King Leopold. Wow, all connected to Regina.
Regina's had a rough life.
Seriously.
Then Stealthy and Graham also died. And Graham was the most brutal death ever. And we'll never forgive the show. We have some complicated lines already. This whole situation is a mess. Mm-hmm. But that's as complicated as it's gonna get, I think.
Between them?
Yeah. And then we have some crazy relationship lines that who knows if they're staying to Graham, Sister Astrid, and fucking Dr. Whale. I can't believe that he's staying on the street. I can't believe that.
Oh, dearie, dearie, dearie.
We have this side, which is kind of an isolated side currently.
Hello.
And other questions are, what happened to Bellfire?
Oh, yeah. That's a big one.
What's going on with Bellfire?
Where'd he go? What's new with him?
What happened to Cora after Regina got married to King Leopold? That's a question.
It's a question. I want to point out the Prince James picture.
Now what? What was that? Okay, James.
What happened to August? That's a big one.
Yeah.
What happened to August when the curse was broken?
Yeah.
Because he was full on wood.
He was
a puppet.
A wooden boy.
He was a wooden boy.
And also, like, what's gonna happen with, like, Emma, Henry, Regina going forward? Because obviously now Regina is, like, they know that she's the evil queen, so, like, they're not gonna really let Henry go back to her. And Henry doesn't want to, so, like, what's going on there?
Yes.
What's going on?
A lot of complicated family issues, as you can see. The fact that Regina is technically Henry's step-great-grandmother, but then also it's his mom, so things are complicated.
And they're just gonna get more so.
Yep. Anyways.
Tune in next time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh my god, be careful.
big hole
oh
there.
Oh my gosh, that's just been ripping this whole summer. Oh my god.
Honestly, kind of cute.
No, I hate it.